All right, now we're going to have the participation part of the show, which we started, how did this start? Okay, so about a year ago in New York, I started playing this thing, which we'll play.
I think we were just joking around.
Playing
this riff.
You know, I started singing, and thought, hey, this is cool, let's do a sing-along every night. So that's how it started. So we're going to start with that tune. And then in California last October, we'll get to that. But anyway, you guys are going to sing. You're going to sing loud and strong. We're going to do the first one, and then we're going to get to the second one, and then, we'll see what happens. So I just started playing this for whatever reason. Don't know why. People went, oh, hey. And all of a sudden, I started going, I don't mind you.
Wasting all my time.
That's
good.
Okay, that's not loud. Let's go. Come on.
Kind of makes my mind. Yeah.
So that's all right.
I needed someone to bleed.
No, I didn't get to bleed.
It's a little bit twisted. That guy in the cars, he looked weird to me. I wouldn't trust him. Plus, he got an incredibly, incredibly hot wife.
I needed to.
So that's like, that right there. I mean, come on. He's twisted. Something's weird there.
We digress. So we were in California the day Tom Petty passed away, so we did this tune, and we've done tons of tunes in tons of different cities in the last year, but this tune always seemed to resonate and everyone had a good time. So we're going to do this one. You guys going to sing? We'll get the guys to do this first. The guys are gonna go free falling. All right, guys, let's go. So when I was a kid, this song was my second favorite Rik Emmett song on radio right now.
Where do you locate?
Yes, that was Dave's favorite.
Yeah, that's the favorite.
That's correct, yes.
No, let me guess, that is your favorite.
Yes.
And you know what? It's not on the set list. Because we didn't rehearse it, and I don't remember it. I hope that hasn't spoiled your night. Because we do have many songs that we did rehearse and wrote in Sharpie on the set list. And those are, that's professional showbiz right there. So we're going to try and hold to that as much as possible. Even though I did promise it was going to come off the rails, it's not going to come off the rails in the direction of the way that you love me. All right. So we're going to do a guitar piece now, which was Dave's second favorite. Back on the rails. Yeah. What was your favorite, Dave?
The way that you love me.
Stop talking.
My favorite instrumental piece was Fantasy Serenade.
Yeah. Second favorite. Fair enough. This is my favorite because this is the one I get the most royalties from. Guitar battle, we've been doing this one for too long.
But this will be the last time.
This started life. I had sold off a bunch of guitars to raise money so that I could have a digital recording studio in my basement. So I bought a bunch of digital recording gear. And when you do that, you have to buy a computer that has multi-track MIDI recording, which is musical instrument digital interface, which you can, keyboard, you can enter stuff, and then you can move it around in the computer like you can fiddle with it and change it. But I can't play keyboards worth shit. So I had this little keyboard, and I could really only sort of get along on the white keys a little. And so I wrote this riff on the keyboard and saved it in the computer, and I had this riff, which was this da 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 da. And if you dialed in cool sounds, it sounded like really great, you know. And so I came up with this tune based around it. And I remember we were mixing stuff. And I still didn't have, I just called it riff in A. It was an A minor riff, because white keys, no sharps, no flats. And this is a true story. So we're mixing it, and my friend Tony Daniels is down in the basement, and I got to take a leak, and I go upstairs to get something to eat, and then I go to the bathroom. And I'm standing there thinking, man, I got to come up with a title for this thing. And I'm standing in front of the washroom, and there's a picture above the toilet. And it's a Russo painting that shows a guy in a sort of a clown outfit with his girlfriend that's dressed in a kind of a German Bavarian thing. And they're clearly going to a masquerade and walking across a moonlit field with trees. And there's, the moon up in the sky, and there's three clouds scudding across the moon in the painting. And I'm standing there taking a leap going, three clouds across the moon. Hey, I'm going to call it Three Clouds Across the Moon. Zip. It's a true story. I'm not making that up. The song is called Three Clouds Across the Moon. Thank you. Like it's funny how, you know, when I was younger and I played, like you could see the tension in my face when I looked at pictures. There was always those, you know, horrible faces that looked like you were constantly having an orgasm. And it's just that, like, the stress and the tension is going to find its way out of your body somehow, right? But the older I get, the funny thing is, like, it's not really in my face much anymore, but, oh, man, does it ever get into my back and my neck? I mean, what the fuck? Oh, my God, you know? Sadly, this marathon of the concert is almost coming to an end. They have one more song that we're going to play for you. And, that's what's going to happen, one more. And then, you know, we're going to take a bow, and you guys are going to give us the standing ovation thing. And that way we don't have to try and figure our way out through these tables in the dark, which is a... Don't understand why they don't put some sort of string of lights or fucking breadcrumbs or something. So then I'll just step up to the mic while you're giving us this tremendous standing ovation. Deep, deep sentiments. And we will say, oh, would you like to hear one more?
Yeah!
And then I'll play one more. And then it'll be over. One encore, that's it. And then I'm going to just beat a hasty retreat through the seats. And I'll be out of this building before you people have finished your fucking coffee.
Who's drinking coffee?
I'm not kidding. Elvis will have left the building. So, and I hope that nothing will happen like what happened last night. I'm going to tell you what happened last night. I got out of here and I got out on the street with a guitar case, I had my suit bag, I had it with my knapsack, and some drunk guy goes, "Hey, Rick! Alright, come here, man!" And he wanted to have a selfie. And then his wife wanted my autograph on her Thunder 7 album. You thought I was going to say something else, didn't you? But I was literally standing out in the middle of the street, it was snowing. And these people were like, "Hey!" I go, "Okay, you people, good, fuck off." No, I love you, but please, fuck off.
We love you too.
Thank you for all your support and all those years and all your money, but leave me alone! So there you go. This is how my career is coming to a screeching halt. Two more songs, okay? That's it. I would never leave without acknowledging the fact that music has been this kind of crazy, sacred, wonderful, amazing, fun, deeply serious thing for me all of my life. And I owe my entire career to the fact that music has unlimited boundaries. And this is a song that I wrote about that, and it's called Magic Power. Woo! Still clear, music.
just can't sort it out. Do you want someone to tell you what they think it's all about? Are you the one?
Sit down, shut up.
He's talking to me for a while.
At least I wasn't like Dave and told you to fuck off.
Sorry about that.
That made history right there. Is that us or you? Oh, Dave.
Transient, dude.
Fuck off. Look, you wanted to quit, but you're fired.
Oh, really?
I told you it was going to come right off the rails. So last night I brought my old Les Paul, and I used it for the last song.
Nice.
And, you realize, you know, why you have... Well, in my case, sometimes as many as 150 guitars. Certain guitars are just the right things for the right kind of gigs, and the Les Paul is not the right guitar for this gig. Which was why I was standing out on the street last night taking it home when that guy waylaid me in this. I'm going to use this. This is the right guitar. I was doing an interview with a guy from, I think it was Sirius Radio, and he asked me something about, you know, guitar heroism and becoming a guitar hero. And I said, you know, I never set out to be a guitar hero.
Like, when I first started, the first good guitar that I ever owned was a nylon string classical guitar. And the first gigs that I played in this neighborhood, there was a West End Y building up Dundas, Annette Street. So it was about five blocks north of where I lived. And they on Thursday nights, they had a coffee house. And I used to go to that coffee house with my acoustic guitar, and I used to play a set that would have like an original song of mine, the Roy Clark version of Malaguena, Paul Simon song, maybe a James Taylor song. And like, I started out more as a singer-songwriter than I did as a electric guitar player, but you know, the way the world went, the Beatles sort of led everybody that was playing guitar because of the Beatles. It led to Eric Clapton and Jimi Hendrix. It led to Cream and you know, Are You Experienced? And so guitar players of my age, everybody was, you know, now chasing guitar heroism. It was just part of the game. But, you know, I mean, in high school, I played in country and western bands and got my union card when I was 17, played in Jewish wedding and bar mitzvah bands with Chet Paskowski. You remember Chet?
The drummer.
So, you know, I mean, I was a singer as much as a guitar player. I was a songwriter more than anything. And the songwriting is the thing that has always meant the most to me. But when I was a teenager, I liked fingerstyle guitar. I liked blues guitar. I liked jazz guitar. And especially as I was heading towards college, jazz was the thing that was, if you wanted somebody to take a can opener and open up your mind and blow it, jazz was the music that made that happen. So I loved guitar players like Wes Montgomery, and Joe Pass in particular was my guy. So this song that I'm gonna play for you now is based on a chord progression that came out of a Joe Pass studies book in 1978-ish. I was on the road and started writing a typical road song. Bands start out, you get forever to make your first album, then you get 12 months to make your second. And you know, if you're lucky enough to make a third, you've been out on the road for 24 months, what the fuck are you gonna write about? You write about the road. So that's why so many bands have road songs by the time they're in their second and third albums. So I was no different. Except mine was, you know, a jazz song based on jazz guitar changes. I played it for Mike and Gil, and they went, what the fuck is that? It's like a jazz song. We're not a jazz band. I said, I know, but you know, and to his eternal credit, Gilmore said to me, you know what, that's a good enough song, it deserves to be on a record. Maybe not our record, but... he said, you know what we'll do, we'll stick it right at the end. It'll be like the Beatles had Her Majesty way at the end of Abbey Road. We'll have this thing that'll be like the P.S. So this has always been my P.S. postscript to, you know, concerts that I've played all my life, and it's a song about how the good things in life have melancholy at their heart, and it's about scotch, which is a little like that too. This is called Suitcase Blues.
Guess I'm making payments.
must be made. I cast another song into Santa's masquerade. Halfway through the circuit and headed for the course. Been gone so long I can't remember what I miss the most. Ah, but me and Johnny Walker, the comfort that he brings, waiting on the telephone that never ever rings. On the lonely road of fortune, and I got the suitcase blues real bad.
And I'm